Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for another edition of Math Encounters. It's my pleasure to welcome you and also to extend our gratitude to the Simons Foundation, whose support allows us to keep running Math Encounters month after month after month and year after year after year, and bring you so many wonderful speakers from all over the world. I hope that you'll join us for many of them, but for now, it is my pleasure to introduce this year's Distinguished Visiting Professor for the Public Dissemination of Mathematics, Alex Kontorovich, who will kick off tonight's talk and introduce our presentation. Thank you, Alex.
Thank you, Cindy, and welcome everybody. It's nice to see all of you here again. We have a real treat for you tonight. Our presenter tonight is Professor Jordan Ellenberg. He's the John D. MacArthur Professor of Mathematics and the Villis Distinguished Achievement Professor of Mathematics, both at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. He, among many, many accolades, as you'll see, I could go on basically all night and not let him say a word, just going through his many awards and honors. Starting, let's say, in high school, he placed second in the nation in the Westinghouse Science Talent Search. He was a three-time participant in the International Mathematical Olympiad, winning a silver and two gold medals, after which he went to Harvard for undergrad, where he was a two-time Putnam Fellow. This is the Putnam exam, one of the hardest exams in all of mathematics, and also the winner of the prestigious Barry Goldwater Scholarship. After that, he remained at Harvard for his PhD, which he received in 1998 under Barry Mazur, where he had a National Science Foundation Graduate Research Fellowship. And in the fall of 98, he arrived at Princeton as an instructor, actually, coincidentally, the same year I arrived there as an undergraduate. And he stayed there until about 2005, which is when he moved to Wisconsin as an assistant professor and quickly rose through the ranks. Among his many, many awards and honors, he was the recipient of a Sloan Research Fellowship and NSF Career Grant. In 2012, he became an inaugural fellow of the American Mathematical Society. In 2014, he won the Mathematical Association of America's Trevor Evans Award. In 2016, he received a Guggenheim Fellowship, and in 2018, a Simons Fellowship. He's very active in public outreach as well. On Twitter, you can find him at, what is it, at Jordan? I didn't write this down. At Jordan Ellenberg?
Oh, it's J.S. Ellenberg.
J.S. Ellenberg, thank you. At J.S. Ellenberg. And he has a blog, Cuomo.comque, which is very active and you should check out. It's maybe more geared towards research mathematics, but also other things. And he writes a lot of general interest articles on mathematical topics at various prestigious publications, such as the New York Times and Slate, Wall Street Journal, Wired, Washington Post. Maybe that's why you're here. You've read some of his popular writings and you want to meet the man in the flesh, or at least the virtual flesh. In 2014, he wrote his first mathematical book, How Not to Be Wrong, published by Penguin Press, which was on the New York Times bestseller list for a number of months, and won the 2016 MAA Euler Book Prize. He was also a mathematical consultant for the 2017 film Gifted, where he also made a cameo appearance in the film, playing a professor lecturing on the partition function and Ramanujan congruences and things like this. Coming up in May of, I guess, next year, 2021, we will all enjoy reading his next book, which is called Shape, but that's not what we're going to be talking about tonight. Tonight, his lecture is on Breaking Up is Hard to Do, the Art of Decomposition. So please help me in welcoming Professor Jordan Ellenberg.
Well, hi, everybody. Thanks so much for coming. I'm going to share my screen. Hey, Alex, will I get my screen share started? You can see my slides. You mentioned I came in second in the Westinghouse Science Fair when I was a senior in high school. You know who came in first?
I don't.
It was a certain guy we both know named Chris Skinner.
Ah, Chris Skinner. Wow. So two mathematicians. It's usually broader than that, right?
So I think we are the only... I think it is the only time that the first and second place winner eventually wrote a paper together. As far as I know, I think we're the only two one-twos to collaborate on the paper, which is pretty fun. So, okay. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming and spending this evening here at MoMath with me and Alex and the MoMath gang, like doing some math. So I want to talk tonight just about a theme that runs through boy, it's just a lot of different types of math, from number theory, which is what Alex and I mostly do for a living, to geometry, to algebra. But because I am a number theorist, that's my day job, I want to start with a basic question about numbers and how we can break them up. So here's a number, okay? It's a, maybe it's a little hard to read the digits, so I can write little commas in here, 17,534,550. And we want to break this up. Okay, what does that mean? Well, it might mean we break it up into digits like I just did with those commas, but that's somehow not so mathematically rich. Maybe a more interesting question is, how can we break this up as two different numbers multiplied together? So for instance, like this. Now, so you might think of this as kind of like a reverse engineering problem. Something we all know how to do is you give me two numbers and I times them together. This is kind of the reverse. I give you a number and I give you the answer and I'm trying to find the multiplication question whose answer is this number. It's like number theory Jeopardy in a way. And how might we do this? Well, if we're trying to find a question whose answer is 17,534,550, a multiplication question whose answer is that, that's tantamount to finding a number which we can divide this big 17 million number by, something that divides evenly into it. And this is actually not that hard to do in this particular case, because if we know something about digits, we know that just looking at this number, it's an even number because it ends in a zero. Being an even number, it means we can divide it by two, meaning we can express it as two times something, and here it is. It's two times this number that's 8,767,275. Okay, so we did it. End of problem, end of talk. No, it's not really the end of the talk. We can go more, we can do more, because now we're sort of flush with ambition and we can take this number that's still pretty big, 8 million some, and ask, well, maybe we can break this thing up still further. And indeed, again, by facts, you know, we look at a number that ends in five and we're like, you know, I think that is going to be a multiple of five. Right? That's going to be five times something. And indeed, so we go one step further and we can, and now it's two times five times something else. So, you know, the metaphor that I like to use for this, as we break up a number as the product of two smaller numbers, multiplicands, as we like to call them, a word I really like to say, the two numbers that are multiplied, is, you know, we're kind of like Paul Bunyan. So here's a picture of Paul Bunyan. I don't know how into American folklore we all are, so I'll just remind you that Paul Bunyan is this kind of like legendary giant lumberjack of the North Woods who swings his giant axe and like breaks up trees into little splinters of wood. So, you know, we've done some of the work. We've gotten down to 2 times 5 times this number that's 1,753,455. But Paul Bunyan is not satisfied. He wants to still swing his axe and break this up number up some more. And here we see he succeeds. He swings his axe and he breaks it up as 165 times 10,627. Okay, fantastic. All right, why give up here? Those numbers are still pretty big. Maybe we can take 10,627. That's the biggest piece left on the table. So that seems like a good thing to attack. Let's try to break that up a little further. Okay, and here we find a different story. So let me make a distinction. This is Happy Paul Bunyan. So whenever you see this image, this is something that we're able to break up into two smaller pieces and Paul Bunyan feels good about himself and has high self-esteem. Whenever we see angry Paul Bunyan, that's because he's arrived at something that he is unable to break up. Try as he might, you cannot express, oh, and here's his friend Babe the Blue Ox, by the way, that's part of the folklore too, that he has a giant blue ox who for some reason wanders around with him there. There it is down here in the corner. Anyway, so Paul Bunyan is unable to factor this number because it is unfactorizable. There is in fact no way to express 10,627 as the product of two smaller numbers, try as you might. So it's what's called a prime number. Here's the definition. A prime number is a number that is impervious to Paul Bunyan's mighty axe. It's not usually expressed in these exact words in a number theory textbook, but this conveys the idea. And so what happens as you continue this process, he might have given up on 10,627, but he could still swing the axe and try to factor 365, that ends in a five, so there's probably a five in it. Maybe we could do a little more work there. And indeed, the way this process works is Paul Bunyan swings the axe and swings it and swings it and swings it until everything that's left on the table is a prime number and you can factor no more, and then you're done. So if we think all the way back, remember, we found at the very beginning a two times five times this number, 1,753,455, and then this 3 and this 5 and this 11, if we put them together, 3 times 5 times 11 is 165. So there's the 165 that we had. Paul swung the axe some more and broke it into 3 times 5 times 11. And, you know, by the way, maybe it's worth saying, you know, I said this is not a talk from the book, but as I think about this material, you know, the book is about geometry and they're like a whole book about triangles. No, it's not. There are some triangles in it, but the truth is that everything is geometric in its way. So I realize even the stuff I'm going to talk about tonight, which is mostly not on its face geometric, it ties in with this stuff I've been thinking about for writing the book. So for example, if we were to sort of make a chart of our progress here, let's see what we did. We started with this number, 1,753,455,0. Can I just say, you know, the Zoom era is terrible in its way, but one nice thing is, isn't it cool the way I can just like doodle on my own slides? Like if we were standing in MoMath together and this was displayed on the screen and I just like whipped out a marker and like ran up and started like writing all over MoMath screen, like they would like justifiably be very annoyed with me. But here, I can just do it and it's great. And it gives me a lot of freedom to kind of, as you guys ask questions or whatever, to kind of go where we go. So this is all good. All right, so what do? We were like, oh, this is 2 times something else. I forgot what it was. It was like 8 million something. And then that 8 million number was 5 times something else, which I do remember because when you take out a 2 and a 5, you're taking out a 10. So it's just lopping a digit off. And then this was 165 times 1067. And then this thing, you could break it into 15 and 11. And then this 15, I'm running out of room at the top of my slides. All right, this is small, as a 3 and a 5. So this kind of picture charts the progress of our factorization. And when you hit a prime number like 10,627, you end, you can't factor anymore. So this kind of picture is what we call a tree. Can you guys buy this as a tree? It has this root down here. This is like where the trunk hits the ground and grabs onto the ground with the roots. And then it kind of branches upward, each branch dividing into smaller and smaller branches. When I say it's a tree, it's not a metaphor. This really is the object that mathematically is called a tree. If anything, the metaphor is a little bit mixed, I know, because Paul Bunyan is actually taking a literal wooden tree and like breaking it up into pieces with his axe. And somehow I'm saying it's the same thing as like building a tree from the ground up. So I realize that those metaphors kind of work across purposes. But nonetheless, I'll just comment that, you know, one thing I learned researching the book is that this geometry of trees is everywhere. Of course, it defines prime factorization, and I write a bit about that. It also is the way we analyze games of strategy. So there's a lot about the interesting development of the strange story of computer checkers and how sort of computers became the best checkers players in the world, which is essentially some incredibly complicated tree analysis. Actually, even the story, it turns out, of how we draw legislative districts and how we assess whether legislative districts are being drawn to nefarious purposes to gerrymander for the process, for the benefit of one party or another. There's trees at the bottom of that too. So this same geometry, the geometry of a tree, is kind of universal and comes up everywhere, not just in factoring primes. So that was a sneak preview. But let's focus a little more on these pieces that we broke the number into. So here's how you think of it. When you chop up a tree into parts, the parts are logs, right? So here's my picture of those two numbers. This is the log of the number 165. This bigger log is log of 10,627. I mean, we want to keep track of the size of the things we break our numbers into. And that's what these logs are for, to remind us of the difference between a small chunk of wood and a bigger chunk of wood. Maybe one way we can to think to keep in mind is that, after all, the log that was this bigger number, 1,753,455, that was the combination of these two smaller logs. So one way to express that kind of equation of timber is that log of 165 plus log of 10,627, those two logs together are log of this bigger number of 1,753,455. Now, maybe this is a good time to confess that, of course, log has another meaning too. So as many of you may know, there is a function called the logarithm. And when you write log of 165, we usually mean the logarithm function applied to 165. And that is not a coincidence. It is a coincidence that the word logarithm sounds like the word for a big round chunk of wood. Like that's the log in the word logarithm comes from the Greek word logos for a word, because it's like just a way of describing something. It's also a coincidence that logarithm sounds like algorithm, by the way. Algorithm is an Arabic word, completely different origin that has nothing to do with logarithm. But what is true is that the log of a number is a way to measure its size, and it obeys this exact same rule. The log of the product of two things is just the sum of the logs of the individual things. So if that's a fact you already know, you can sort of take this to be some true fact about a button on your calculator called log. Or if not, you can just take log to mean some vague measure of the size of a thing. And if you break the thing into two pieces, the log of the big thing should be the sum of the logs of the two smaller things. And in that sense, we're going to use logs throughout this talk in contexts that are not well measured by the log button in your calculator, but are more general. Okay, time for digression. One thing that is very natural to wonder at this juncture is, what about one?
And sorry, what about another digression, which is a poll. So if everybody could enter the poll, that allows us to know not just who's in the room who signed up, but who else is in the room for our total population. Thank you.
Alex, did you check the Poissonity of this afternoon's statistics?
It goes 1 through 10, and there were a couple that were more than 10.
There were?
Yes. I'm not sure how many is. Whole school's watching somewhere.
Wow.
But it started out Poisson, and then there was a spike at the end.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Why isn't one a prime? And I want to point out that if you go back to my definition, I said, well, what does a prime number mean? It means a number that Paul Bunyan cannot break up any further. Can't be factored into the product of two small numbers. And boy, I got to admit, that is true of one. No question, right? That just is true. You can't factor one into two smaller numbers. So you might say, I'm just forced to say that one actually is a prime. But you know, in math, we're never forced. The point I want to make that's really important about the way math works is that a definition does not come to us from God, right? We're not forced to say like there's some absolute truth about whether a number is prime or not. We choose what our definition is. We choose what we mean by prime number, and we choose that definition to suit our purposes best. So to some extent, this question doesn't even really have like a very definitive answer. And maybe a good point to make is that one answer to this question is, yeah, it used to be. And in fact, Alex and I had a very interesting discussion of this like over the course of this afternoon and later today. And Evelyn Lamb kind of jumped in with a great article she wrote in Scientific American. In fact, maybe I'll even put her name here. So go look this up if you want to hear about the interesting history of this question. I can't really put a link on the slide, but if I put her name and Scientific American, if I can spell Scientific American and search for one prime or something like that, I promise you will find her very interesting and enlightening article. So this was the subject of some controversy. What was the best definition of a prime number? And even up to the early 20th century, there were still kind of some holdouts who were like, I think the definition of prime should include one. In fact, Alex pointed me to a great quote by the number theorist D.H. Lamer, who not only sort of said, I don't like these people who who exclude one. They're like, if you exclude one, because it's different from the other primes, why don't you exclude two? That's different from the other primes. It's even. That's weird. I don't think it's a very powerful argument, but that was his take. Anyway, the point is we have settled now. I think any contemporary number theorist, there's nobody left who prefers the definition of prime that includes one. And we could have a whole hour about the pros and cons of that. But let me kind of give you one take that is relevant to the current discussion about decomposition, about why I wouldn't consider one prime. So let's think of it like this. Let's think of it in terms of our friends, the logs. So any number n, and you know, I wrote n like a variable, but it can be whatever number you want. If you prefer to think of something more concrete, you could say like 13. I just picked the number out of my hat. So 13 can be factored as 1 times 13, true. So that means that the 13 log is the combination of the log of 13 and the log of 1. But wait a minute. These two things are the same. So we're saying, like, if I take a hunk of wood, a log, and I chop it up, and one piece is, I'm like, okay, the first piece, I chopped it into two pieces. The first piece is the entire original piece. Okay, then what's the other piece? Nothing, right? There's nothing left. And so that tells you that because this is the case, because of this equation, log of one has to be zero. Like there's nothing to it because it doesn't add anything to log of 13. So I guess the way I would think of it is that if I promised you, if you handed me a log and was like, chop this up into two smaller pieces, and I was like, okay, I did it. And you were like, what do you mean you did it? I'm like, I did it. I chopped it into two smaller pieces. Like, you didn't even swing the axe. What are you talking about? I said, like, yeah, I chopped it into two smaller pieces. One piece is the entire log, and the other piece is nothing. Wouldn't you on some level feel like I cheated you? Wouldn't you on some level feel like I hadn't actually done the thing that I said that I did? I think so. I think so. I think that feels like cheating. And so this is the sense in which we don't really want to count one as a prime factor or 13 equals 13 times 1 is a decomposition of 13. Because that would be exactly like saying I chopped up the log by just declaring that I chopped it up into two pieces, one of which was nothing at all. Okay. End of digression. That's one reason that I personally am on team one not prime. Okay, so let's summarize what we've done so far. Factorization, I took this big number, I swung my axe and I swung my axe and I swung my axe until my axe couldn't do any more work, and I ended up with like a list of prime numbers. You can do this with any number you want. Any number can be factored into primes, and actually better yet, and this is actually not such an easy fact to prove, there's really only one way to do it. I mean, I might have made different choices along the way, but I would always end up with the same set of prime numbers. Maybe not in this order, I mean, but apart from that, there's only one way to factor a prime. So in some sense, this breaks the theory of multiplication of integers, of numbers, into two parts. One, how do we factor? And two, what are the primes? Like, how do we do the breakup? And then what might we end up with when we break up? So there's a sort of another metaphor going away from arborism for a minute. A metaphor very commonly used for this, which I think is a good one, is this, the periodic table, a picture many of you have seen before. Maybe not with such an awesomely trippy backdrop as this one that I found, but this is the periodic table showing all the chemical elements. And the reason that we care about the periodic table is that every molecule can be broken up into atoms in exactly one way, right? So if somebody gives you some methane, and you know that a methane molecule is going to be 6 carbons and 4 hydrogens. Not on my slide, but I remembered that. Good for me. I had to like make up a chemical that I knew the CH4. And so once again, when you do chemistry, like a natural question about molecules is, one, how do you actually figure that out? You have some substance, like how do you actually determine what the chemical composition of that molecule is in terms of how many copies of each atom do you have? And then you want to know, like, what are all the atoms? What are all the types of atoms that you put together to form molecules? In other words, what are all the chemical elements? And so in that sense, it's very similar. All the huge chemical richness of all the molecules in the world are built up out of combinations of these elementary, well, elements, atoms of these elements, in the same way that all numbers are built up out of these primes. Now, I do want to emphasize, there is one serious disanalogy embedded in this analogy, which is that there are only finitely many elements. Exactly how many maybe is a little bit delicate to say. On this periodic table, there are 118 listed. It is certainly possible, and people do this, they like work very hard in their labs to construct some so-called transuranic element, and out of even more protons in the nucleus, and anything in this range down here is like extremely unstable. You get, you know, you're very impressed with yourself. You can put together some atom that like lasts for like a picosecond before it explodes in a cloud of radiation. So I don't know exactly where the limit is. Maybe somebody made 119 since they made this periodic table, but there's certainly some finite list of atoms that there could be. And the list of atoms that actually occur in the natural world is even like much shorter than this. There's plenty of things in this periodic table that are not included. Primes, by contrast, are infinite in number. There's not some finite list of primes out of which everything is made. That's a very old result. It's actually as old as Euclid, and probably prior to Euclid. I mean, one thing about Euclid, by the way, because I wrote a lot about him in the book, is that there's somehow a myth that Euclid was like, here I am, like sitting down to create geometry. Like, no, Euclid was kind of an encyclopedist. Like a lot of the stuff he wrote down, it's pretty clear, was known to other mathematicians around the time. He approached things much more systematically than other writers, but there's really no way we'll ever know like sort of what he came up with and what was stuff he was recording that was as he was recording essentially the mathematical vanguard of his time. Okay, end of chemistry metaphor. Now I want to take factorization for the second half of this talk in a bunch of completely different directions. And then we're going to kind of try to synthesize at the end. So we talked a lot about numbers. Let me talk a little bit about geometry. And in particular, the geometry of surfaces. Okay, so here's a couple of surfaces. One of them is just very simple. It's this like little filled in circle you see here, which is a disk. And then this one, it's just what you think it is. It's called just what you think it might be called. So actually, I always wonder like what people see when they see this surface, if people want to suggest what they think it should be called. But I will tell you, the technical term for this surface is in fact a pair of fans, which is what it is, right? It's kind of this particular one is drawn in such a way it's like kind of like a pair of cowboy pants, like a guy's like coming into the saloon with like two six shooters, one on each hip with this kind of cowboy pose. But you know, we're topologists for the moment, for the next, let's say about 12 to 13 minutes. So we don't care about such matters as the exact angles of the legs or the length of the legs. Like we don't want this thing to be like ripped up and like really changed in its shape, but you know, deforming it in various ways is totally fine. It's still a pair of pants, just a different pants. Now here's what's cool, that these are two very simple surfaces. But it turns out that I can take a more complicated surface and break it up into pants and disks. So here's an example. Here's a kind of a complicated a three-holed donut that I've drawn. I didn't actually draw this one. I took it from the internet, but somebody drew it. And then these loops have been drawn on it in a way to cut it into pieces. And here's the thing. These pieces are pairs of pants. That might not be obvious at first. Let's take a second to actually like look at it and think about it. So this thing, I claim, here's the waist, right? So I'm looking at this part of the surface over here. Here's the waist. But then what I've done is I've taken the two legs and I've sewn them together. So this is a pair of pants. It's just that I've sewn the two legs together. If I were to cut these loops, what I would have left would actually be a pair of pants. This one too, actually, this is probably like the most pants-like looking one. If I cut these three loops, what I would have left would be a pair of pants. ditto here, where again, I've sewn the two legs together, but if I cut the loop, I would get another pair of pants over here. This one looks a little different when you look at it, but sort of imagine this as the waist, and then these as the two legs. They're very short, but this is kind of like, if you know, if you have a pair of jeans and you like, you know, they kind of gotten frayed, like your favorite pair, you wear them all the time, and they're kind of raggedy in the knees. And then, you know, you kind of cut off the legs, making the legs shorter. It becomes a pair of shorts, and then maybe they're still too long, so you should cut them into like sort of short shorts. Like that's sort of what you're looking at here. You imagine this sort of pair of denim short shorts. It's still a pair of pants, right? It's still a thing with a waist hole and two leg holes. And maybe finally, let me kind of look over here. This one, what I've done is if you sort of, this is a disc, right? This is the disc. If I get rid of that, then I have what may you may think of as like a cylinder with a hole punched in it. But from our sort of very floppy perspective, we might as well think of that as here's the waist hole, and then there's the two legs. So it's like a very narrow waisted pair of pants, but it is a pair of pants. So I guess in all, did I count this properly? I think we have five pairs of pants and a disc glued together to make this surface. So, you know, I like to sort of stop from time to time and like do a little exercise. We don't just kind of sit here listening to the sound of my voice. So we're gonna do, let's do one of these ourselves. And by the way, I should say, again, pair of pants is the correct technical mathematical term for this kind of surface. You could look it up and see like lots of papers about them. This thing we did here where we decompose some arbitrary surface into a bunch of pants, well, it's called just what you think. It is a pants decomposition. And we just all say stuff like this in seminars without chuckling. It's just like a normal math word for us. Well, it was common. You could search pants decomposition and the whole thing wouldn't be about like fashion. It would be about topology of surfaces. Okay, let's do one. So here's, oops, I wrote that on the next slide too. You know, is this pants? Well, the answer is gonna be yes. The question is, can you draw loops on this two-hole donut in a way that cuts it up into pants? Actually, you don't even need discs for this. You can cut it up in a way that cuts it entirely into pants. I'm gonna give us about a minute to talk about this. If it's cool, I'm actually gonna get a glass of water. I forgot to sort of set myself up a little before we started, and I'm feeling a little bit. So in the time it takes me to get a glass of water, which will be about 60 seconds, I want you guys to think about how you could cut this surface up into pants, and then we'll reconvene and like see how you did and like talk about it. And then we'll draw it on the slide. Okay, be right back. Be done when I get back. I don't think that was even 60 seconds. I think I did it way faster.
Jordan, can you see the chat? Everyone's putting their suggestions in there, or should I read them out to you?
Oh, I cannot see the chat while I'm sharing the screen. Actually, I can actually make myself see it. Hold on. I might get the gray box if I do that. So tell me if I create the gray box. Okay. Okay, seems like... Wow, there's like a lot of stuff. Okay. Including some good Three Dog Night references. Love it. Okay. All right. I want to hear actually there's a bold claim that you can do it in one cut that I want to hear about. How do you do it in one cut? Yeah, Mark Prim.
Okay, so like, why don't you just cut it straight down what looks like vertically, but it's a bit slanted to the right?
Like this? Like that?
Yep.
Just okay, like so that. I take a big knife, and I do this.
And it gets you through the pants.
So let's figure out what the cross section is. So it would be kind of cutting it there. there.
Yep. And there.
Great. Okay. So indeed, what's cool is, you know, I did this talk in the afternoon and we got a totally different cut. So first of all, I feel like this is a little bit hard to parse this picture I drew. The great topologist Poincaré said that geometry is the art of reasoning well from badly drawn figures. He was a great geometer and a terrible drawer of figures. He had awful handwriting. He was ambidextrous, and the joke around Paris was that his handwriting was equally good with both hands, which meant it was equally bad with both hands. And his pictures were terrible, but so that's my excuse. But was that Mark who just said that? I don't know if that was Mark I was talking to who.
Yes, it was.
Okay.
Yes, it was Mark.
So yeah, you could think of this as one cut in that you could like take your knife and do this with one cut. I prefer to think of it as three cuts, if that's okay, because there's like three little loops in the surface I'm cutting along. There's like three points of contact with the knife. So I would call this three cuts, but it's a matter of nomenclature in some sense. And indeed, if I cut these three loops, what's left is gonna be two pair of pants with a sort of jaunty backwards curve to the legs, but so be it. Wait, Jeanette says she can make it in two cuts? Okay, I want to see this. This is Alex, it's cool if we spend some time doing this, right? Because now people are into it. Okay, so first of all, comment. This afternoon we did this, and here's what we came up with. So I'm gonna erase this. I'm gonna erase the mark cut.
Yeah.
We did this. Which also works, right? Here we have like sort of each pair of pants has the two legs sewn together. So this is a different way with three cuts and into two pairs of pants. And actually I said in the talk, Alex was there, he could attest to this, like, but you know, there's lots of different ways we can do this with three cuts and this is cool. So this evening we sort of organically found a different way to do it. Okay, Jeanette, I wanna hear the two cut way. If you feel like turning on your mic and telling you about it, you don't have to. All right, how about anybody who says they can do it with less than three cuts? I'm interested. I see actually several people. I see a Dave Niponsky says he can do it in one. Jeanette says he can do it in two. Anybody wants to jump in? Dilip says one, but I think Dilip has the same thing in mind as Mark, like one cut with a knife, but that cuts three loops.
If someone wants to speak, if you could just raise your hand and
Oh, I see. Do only I have the power of unmuting? Okay. Mark, I already used, so I'm going to give Jeanette a chance. Oh, you're Mark Primack. Sorry, I called you Mark Prim, but you're Mark Primack. All right, I'm going to, can we unmute Jeanette?
Yeah, I'm unmuted. I'm on my mom's account.
Oh, sorry. Not Jeanette.
So it's actually Ben. Hi, Ben. I can't annotate, but if you could fold it across the middle so the two holes are on top of each other,
mm-hmm.
and then you could just cut it in two cuts, or you could then fold it so then they become more of a, like two, like a W, and then it'd become a U. You fold it in half, and then you fold it in half again.
I see, but see, I think that I think that would be fewer like swings of the knife, but I think in terms of what the cross section would look like how many, like in other words, if I were to draw not the knife, but just, okay, I'm having a little trouble visualizing. If I folded it up, like you said, like let's say I folded it and then cut here, I would sort of cut at the same time with one swipe, I would cut this and this.
Yeah.
But I would still count that as two cuts because there's two little circles on the surface that I'm cutting. But you're right that I could do it in one swing.
Okay.
Yeah, I think people are getting that maybe my notion of cut, we haven't defined it very well. So let me say what I mean. This is a little more topology than I was gonna do, but why not? So to me, a cut means I draw a circle on the surface and then cut along that. So like this is a single cut, that circle that I'm drawing, and I snip it. Whereas if I do this thing that Mark suggested, it's absolutely true that I could sort of take a certain very sharp plane and intersect it with this surface, and the intersection would be those three circles. Yes, what Dave said, a cut, by cut, I mean, I want like a circle is a connected thing. I just mean like, I'm cutting along a circle on the surface. And so this would be three cuts by my standards. Okay, Mark really wants to say something. So let's hear one more thing from Mark. I think Mark wants to say something. Oh, do I have to do the...
Oh, okay. So like if you take a line going through two tangent points of the holes that still goes through the body and extend it.
So like from here to here, but it's going to go through the middle of the surface?
Like take the longest line possible. Like it's sort of like a diagonal. If that's a vertical.
Okay, like you're doing, we want to do something like this.
Yes.
Exactly. A path like that.
That's
one. Very impressed with myself for understanding what you meant. Okay.
That's one cut. And that's two pairs of pants.
Okay. So I would say now we're testing my drawing abilities to the max. I think if you cut in that direction, the cross section would kind of look like this, and then maybe like this. And then at that point of tangency, it would look like this. What do you think? But these ones are like underneath. Maybe I should have dotted them. Do you think I drew that picture properly? So I claim this is still three. By my lights, it's still three different circles, but they're touching. But it is like, I mean, it is like one swoop of the knife, but... okay, wait, I think one other person, I think Teddy Y super, super wants to talk. People who want to talk should like raise their hand, I think. Oh, there's Teddy Y. Okay, here we go.
I wanted to say the same thing.
Oh, you had the same diagonal kind of dude in mind?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, then I'm going to let Phoenix talk. How about that? Because Phoenix wanted to talk too. Phoenix, you're on.
I'm thinking my idea is with less than three cuts. So to make this work, there's currently zero holes. And you're going to, if you want to make two pairs of pants, you need six holes. And every cut makes two holes, so you can only use three cuts. So that means if you want to do it with two cuts, you have to have one pair of pants. But if you want one pair of pants, you're going to need three holes, and then every cut makes two holes. Basically, every cut makes two holes. But we need, so the number of holes must be a multiple of two. But since every pair of pants has three holes, the number of holes must also be a multiple of three, which means at minimum it's six. And since every cut makes two holes, to make it have six holes, you're gonna need to make three cuts. And that means that you need three cuts to make it work. And there was no way with less than three cuts.
Heroic, this I like. Okay, so let me try to unpack what, that was Phoenix talking just now, right? So it would be, this is great. I don't know if anybody like, who's not a kid is in this, but I hope it's just like me and a bunch of kids. That's what I'm imagining now. Okay, so the argument is every time I make a cut, let's look at how many, what should we call it? An opening, how many openings there are in a, so like if I do this, I cut along this loop and let me try to draw this. Do I dare try? So it's like this, but now it's kind of cut there. Oh my gosh, my drawing is really bad. That's pretty good though, right? It's okay. And now I've made a thing which has like two openings in it. And every single time I cut, as Phoenix says, I'm going to create two more. Like if I were to cut here, I would, okay, some delicate erasing is going to happen. I would then have a thing which looked like this, and I made two more openings for a total of four. And as Phoenix says, if I'm going to end up with something that looks like a bunch of pairs of pants, like n pants equals 3n holes, so I certainly need to do cuts until I get up to a multiple of three, but it can't be one because I would need to make exactly three holes, which I can't do because the number of holes needs to be even. And so the most efficient way I can do it is to cut three times, making six holes, which is two pairs of pants, which is what I get. Okay, Mark really wants to talk, so I'm gonna let him do it. We're just completely going rogue at this point.
Okay, so I agree with that first cut. And if you take a cut from the center of that cut to the side, if you go like to the right, if you make a cut to the right.
So wait, you want me to undo this thing? Hold on. No. So let me glue these back together. So you're saying undo this, and now you're saying cut like here?
Yep. Just like that.
Okay, so one thing is, I will say that part of what I have in mind in the rules of the game is that the loops are not allowed to cross. I'm not quite sure what you have in mind, but like, are you saying I sort of cut and then come around back and cut here?
Yes. Yes, I think so.
Yeah, so at this, is a great idea. It kind of breaks the rules, but I didn't really tell you the rules, so I can't really blame you for that. Let's draw it, because you would be able to get a pair of pants this way, but in the following sense, it would kind of look like, now it would look like this. You guys are testing my drawing ability to the max. Let's see, what would this be? No, I think this is kind of, this is a little different.
There are those things that connected on the top and bottom also. Not trying to test your drawing ability.
Oh wait, did I mess up the drawing? It's totally possible I did.
I don't know.
No, I think this is what it would look like. No, I see your point. It would be, it would be more like this. But even so, I think this is not quite pants. And in some sense, we enter into a different zone if we allow our cuts to cross each other. So in my original picture here, you'll notice that the cuts were all separate from each other. Like all, let's see how many, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these seven cuts were, didn't touch each other. And by the way, let's use the Phoenix philosophy on this one, because this will be fun, a little bit of number theory. This ought to work. So the claim is that every time I make one of these kinds of cuts, I create two openings. So I guess that would be like 14. And then you're like, wait, I thought it was supposed to be a multiple of three. Well, what happens is there's one aspect of this one that we didn't use in the second one, which is this operation of using the disc, right? This is like five pants and a disc. And gluing down a disc removes a hole. So, right, ready? Five pair of pants should have 15 openings. One of those openings is closed up by gluing the disc on, and that makes 14, which is exactly right, which is exactly the seven opening, the 14 openings we created by cutting seven times. So that suggests, by the way, that maybe you think we could do, so can we do, and I actually have not worked out the answer to this question, it's just what occurs to me given what you guys said. Can we do two cuts, making four openings? and glue on one disc to make this. Oh no, that's the wrong way. I guess it would be. Yeah, maybe one cut. All right, ready? Can we do one cut making two openings and get a pair of pants with one disc, one pants, one disc. I actually don't think we can do that, but I will leave that as an exercise. Okay. Guys, I want to move on and talk about other stuff because we're already 6:54, and I want to talk a little bit about decomposing other stuff. I hope it's cool, MoMath people, that we like. I'm a big believer when I teach that I'd rather go in a place the students are taking me than cover all the material.
Totally cool. Yeah, this was great. Keep going. It's great.
So okay, but let's cut this off here. We can talk about it more after. I think the answer. So. For those who want to think about it, think about this. I think the answer is no. We can discuss it after. Okay, so just to comment, there's a whole other story I'm not going to tell where what I just said was understood in the early part of the 20th century. A big theme of the rest of the century was trying to understand to what extent you could extend this to three-dimensional spaces. And this was like a lot harder and there's like beautiful successes. We're not going to talk about them. We're going to talk about stuff that's more down to earth, okay? So let's talk about permutations. Okay, so a permutation is just a way of rearranging the elements of some set. And let's not go crazy here. Let's say of finite sets, everything we're going to talk about here is finite. So for instance, here's a permutation. I start with the letters A, B, C, D, E, and now I put them in a new order. I make A go to C, B goes to E, C goes to D, D goes to A, E goes to B. Okay, I want to like chop these up with my axe. Now, what could that mean? It's like a number, we know it's like breaking it up as a product of two things. What does it mean to break a permutation into two parts? Well, let me make the following observation. A gets replaced with C. C gets replaced with D, and D gets replaced with A. And as you can see, we've cycled back to where we started. And that is no coincidence. That has to happen. And that's because we're only dealing with finitely many things. You wander around in a finite space, and after a certain amount of time, you have to get back to where you started. There's no possibility that you don't. So that gives us a very natural way to break this permutation into pieces. Namely, you start with A goes to C, C goes to D, D goes to A. And then if you sort of keep on running this permutation, you sort of cycle forever. Well, what about B? Okay, B goes to E, and E goes back to B. So that's like a shorter cycle, it's just of length two. So we have a cycle of length three and a cycle of length two. Okay, so Paul Bunyan's happy, right? Because he succeeded in doing the thing he likes doing, which is like taking a thing and breaking it up into smaller things. And we can even sort of, let's get back to our metaphor. If this A, B, C, D, E is like a log of size five, right? Because it's like five things. We've broken it up into two smaller logs, like a log of size three and a log of size two. And this is like, you know, writing the permutation this way somehow is very useful. It sort of tells you that it doesn't mix up the A's and the B's or the A's and the E's. It kind of works over here on the A, C's and D's, and it does one thing. And then over here, totally separately, it switches B and E. A cycle of length two is like a switch, what we like to call an involution in the game. And by the way, maybe I should have, it occurs to me now that we can't, there are also here permutations that you can't break up, right? Like, let's say I had A, B, C, D, E, and then instead A went to B, B went to C, C went to D, D went to E, and E went back to A. Then no matter where you start, you're going to use up everything. You're going to use up all five letters before you get back to where you started. So this, if I had another slide for it, I could have written this with like, angry Paul Bunyan, and that would have been something he can't break with his axe. So, what are the atoms? Well, I just drew one for you. You know, what are the permutations that you can't break up? I just drew one whose log was 5. A very simple kind is if just A goes to A. That's what's called a fixed point for natural reasons. And obviously you can't break that up any further because it's only one thing already. So that has log 1. We saw one like this where you just switch two things. That can't be broken up any further. Log 2. Here, as you see, I wrote it wrong on my slide and people pointed that out this afternoon. So I fixed it. A, B, C goes to B, C, A. It's log 3, log 4. So one difference, one thing that's very nice is that the atoms, the atomic theory of permutations, is very easy to understand. There's one atom of each size. One log of each size, if you like. Okay, hold that thought. We're going to come back to it. I'm going to give one more example of things that we can decompose, namely polynomials. So we talked about numbers, pants, permutations, and now I want to talk about polynomials. Okay, so here's a function, x cubed minus 4x squared plus 5x. We can factor this as x times x plus 1 times x minus 5. And actually, one way to do this, if you guys like graphs, if you have like Desmos or something, you can just type this in and make a graph of it. And you can see like, and I want us to like focus on this because this is a principle we're going to be using a lot in the next like 10 minutes or so. The fact that this factors as x times x plus 1 times x minus 5 means that if I plug in x equals 0 to the function, I get 0. And look, there it is, crossing the x-axis at x equals 0. If I plug in x equals negative 1, I get 0. And if I plug in x equals 5, I also get 0. So another way to say this is that x equals 0, x equals negative 1, and x equals 5 are roots of this polynomial and fans of algebra 2. I think we teach this in algebra 2. We'll remember that having a linear factor x minus a, for a polynomial to have a linear factor x minus a, is exactly equivalent to this polynomial having a as a root. So drawing graphs like this is a very good way to help us factor. On the other hand, what if I said y equals x squared plus 1? Let's graph that. Looks kind of like this, right? Who needs Desmos? We can just draw it. Okay, it looks kind of like that. It's a parabola. But this parabola is entirely above the x-axis, right? X squared plus 1 equals 0. This has no solutions. Okay, I know there's some complex number fans out in the audience. For now, for this moment, we are not talking about complex numbers. We're talking about real numbers. And so among the real numbers, there are no solutions to this polynomial. Somebody did it, and I just said, we're not gonna do it. Okay, anyway, I saw those complex numbers in the chat. Okay. So this polynomial cannot be factored into linear factors, not over the real numbers at any rate. So, okay, this is my chance. Angry Paul Bunyan sees x squared plus 1 and cannot factor it any further and is angry. So there's a whole story we could tell about factoring polynomials, but I'm going to take it in a slightly different direction for reasons that will become clear at the end. I want to do something weird and say, suppose 5 is equal to 0. Okay, that may be like a weird thing for me to say, and one response would be like, but 5 isn't equal to 0, so why would you say that? Well, you're all here, you've agreed to spend this time with me, so let's bear with me for a minute. In number theory, it turns out to be of great, great interest to think about number systems in which 5 is equal to 0. We call this modding out by 5. So if you've done go all the way back to like, you know, fourth grade and dividing and taking a quotient and a remainder. We are interested in what is the number mod 5. Another way to think of it is it's like clock arithmetic, right? Where if it's 8 hours after 7 o'clock, what time is it? Is it 15 o'clock? No, because when you hit 12, you go back around to 0. And so 15 o'clock is the same thing as 3 o'clock because any multiple of 12 hours doesn't change where you are on the clock. It's kind of like that, except instead of 12, we do 5. And in this world where we insist that 5 equals 0, all kinds of crazy stuff happens. And in particular, a crazy thing that happened is that x squared plus 1 now factors. Because if 5 is 0, then 1 is negative 4, right? Because 1 plus 4 equals 0, so 4 is negative 1, 1 is negative 4. But x squared minus 4 does factor. It factors as x plus 2 times x minus 2. Another way to say this is that, wait, having a linear factor is supposed to tell me that I found the roots of a polynomial. And indeed, 2 is a root of x squared plus 1, because 2 squared plus 1 is 4 plus 1, which is 5, but that's also 0. So because people put in the chat, like, what about x squared plus 1 equals x plus I times x minus I? And I was like, well, no, we're not going to talk about complex numbers right now. I will comment that you might feel inclined to say that if I reduce I mod 5, okay, ready? I divide I by 5, what's the remainder? Is 2. Because it's something which whose square is negative 1, right? Okay, that's like, it's kind of like the meme where it's like the sort of human brain is like, x squared plus 1 can't be factored. And then like the sort of advanced brain is like, I mod 5 is 2. And then galaxy brain is like, wait, is I mod 5 2? Or is it negative 2? Because those are both roots. Or is it 3, which is negative 2? Well, contemplating that question takes us into some very deep parts of number theory. So I'll just say that this is like a reasonable kind of thing to say if you want to like start reducing complex numbers mod 5, which is a fun kind of thing to do. But for us, we don't need to think about it. To be honest, we can just say 5 is 0 for us, so I don't need to talk about I. I can just say this polynomial has 2 roots, 2 and negative 2, and that gives me a factorization. So yay, we made Paul Bunyan happy again. Now he factored this polynomial that couldn't be factored before. Okay, question. By the way, guys, I'm over my allotted time. I know it. The MoMath people told me it was okay to kind of bleed out into the allotted time. So I hope people will stay. Feel free to stick around. I will probably need...
You're fine to keep going.
Okay. No, I'm going to keep going. I'm just trying to give people an honest accounting of how much longer I'm going to be talking. Maybe like 10 more minutes probably from this point on, I think, if it's like we did last time. I just want people to know what they're in for. You know what I mean? Okay. So Paul Bunyan's happy. We factored this polynomial. And maybe, emboldened by our success, we're like, maybe in this new world where 5 equals 0, maybe we can just factor everything. And so that's my next question. The question is that true? Are there polynomials that we cannot factor? Well, okay. Let me say that in some sense, the answer to this question is yes. Like for instance, let me give a trivial answer. X minus 2 can't be factored. Why? Because it's already a linear polynomial. What can we factor it into? We can't factor it into two polynomials of smaller degree because it doesn't get any smaller without being constant. So this is not of interest. So let's say a polynomial of degree bigger than 1. And furthermore, let's say one thing, because I have to be a little careful what I mean by factorizing. So into 2 non-constant polynomials. Why do I say that? Because let me say something silly we could do. You might say, well, I can factor x minus 2. I can factor it as, because here's the thing about working mod 5. You'll notice that, for instance, 2 times 3 is 6, which is 1. So I could say, x minus 2 is 2 times 3x minus 6, because that's 2 times 3 times x minus 2, which is 1. All right, this is like a little bit like Paul Bunyan kind of pretending to cut something and just saying like, okay, I cut it, but the one part of it is nothing. This is a little bit cheating, because if we allow this, then anything can be factored in exactly this way. So this is not allowed. And I'm saying, I want us to be able to factor it. The question is, can we think of a polynomial that can't be factored into two non-constant polynomials mod 5? And I'm gonna let us spend some time and think about that. Let's give it a full minute and don't post in the chat for the next 60 seconds, because I want everybody to have time to think about it a little bit and see if we can either come up with some examples or convince ourselves that there are none. All right. Let's come back together. Let's see. Okay, so I think I see one hand up, Phoenix. Let's see what Phoenix wants to say. I think if I click this, then Phoenix can talk. Is that right? Did I do it or no?
I think you unmuted me instead.
Wait, yeah. Phoenix, I think Phoenix can talk now.
So I just wanted to say that I'm thinking that maybe x squared minus 2 might, I'm thinking that x squared minus 2.
Okay, x squared minus 2, let's try it. And by the way, I see in the chat some other suggestions. I see, so Logan Gilbert said x squared plus 3, and I'll point out that that is the same answer, right? Because plus 3 and negative 2 are the same number, so we have at least 2 votes for this. All right, let's see if we can convince ourselves. Why do you think this can be factored?
How did you describe it?
Why do I think this can't be factored? Because to factor it, it would need to be x plus k times x minus k. Wait, it's x plus root 3 times x minus root 3.
I think it's x plus root 2 times x minus root 2.
Oh, yes, it is.
So if it could be, I agree with you here, if it could be, it would be x minus a times x plus a with a squared equals 2, right? That's what I mean. So the question is there a number whose square is 2? In the usual number system we're used to, well, not as an integer, maybe as a real number, yes. But what about in this number system? Is there a number whose square is 2? And actually, we can check this. What's cool about this number system is that there are only 5 numbers. So it's pretty easy computationally to check. So let's do it.
Oh, I can't.
0, 1, 2, 3, and 4.
You can do 0, 1, 4, 4, 1. The square root of 0, 1, 4, 4, 1. That's what you get.
Yeah, so 0 squared is 0. 1 squared is 1. 2 squared is 4. 3 squared is 9, but 9 is also 4. And by the way, it makes sense that 2 and 3 would have the same square because 2 is negative 3. Two numbers, you know, the negative of a number should have the same square, is it? And then 4 squared is 16, but 16 is 1 plus 15, so it's 1. And indeed, because 4 is negative 1, its square better be 1. And you see what's not on the list? 2.
Or 3. And also, by the way, just in case you didn't catch this, going back to the subject of the pants real quick, what I was trying to say with my argument is that since there must be 3 holes per pair of pants, and you started with 0 holes, so since the number of holes must be twice the number of cuts, but it also must be divisible by 3. So to make it divisible by 2 and 3, it has to be at least 6. And if it's 6, yeah, then you need 3 cuts. So it needs
to be. That's what I said. Mm-hmm. I thought I paraphrased that.
Okay, I just wanted to do
that. Okay, maybe I did not paraphrase it well enough, but that was what I was intending to. That was what I was intending to repeat about the argument. Okay, so this is cool. So we did it. We found at least 2 polynomials, quadratic polynomials, polynomials of degree 2, which cannot be factored, modulo 5. So these are bigger atoms, right? There's the atoms which are the linear polynomials, and now we've found at least 2 atoms whose log is 2. Oh, I forgot to say what log is. Well, let's say it on this next slide. Ready? Here we go. There's these atoms, these guys clearly can't be factored. And now there's x squared minus 2 and x squared minus 3, but those are not the only ones. Fun exercise if you want to. X squared plus x plus 1 also can't be factored mod 5. And in fact, there are 7 atoms of degree 2. And here too, the natural notion of how big an atom is what is its degree as a polynomial. And so that's what we're gonna mean by log here. So, you know, the log of a linear polynomial is 1, the log of x squared plus x plus 1 is 2. And if you really want a challenge, there's a very beautiful formula for how many atoms there are of each size. So, I mean, here there's 5 atoms. And here, I guess there's 7 more. So I guess there's 10 atoms. And no, it is not just that the number of atoms is degree times 5. It's more complicated than that. So I will leave it as a fun exercise to figure out how many atoms there are of each degree.
It's pretty hard though, but it's worth it. It's fun to think about. And of course, there's nothing, by the way, there's nothing special about 5 here. 5 just happens to be like a nice small prime that gave me enough room to write down some examples, but we could do this modulo any prime. Okay, so last thing I want to talk about tonight, we're going to kind of bring it all together. I want to talk about the notion of a smooth factorization. So what does that mean? Well, okay, like if you like were grinding something up in the blender, as in like what I was making for dinner between our two talks today, grinding it up smooth means there's like no big chunks left, right? So smooth factorization is kind of like that. We say a factorization is smooth if none of the factors has a log that's bigger than half the log of the thing you started with. So something that's really not smooth would be 10,627, because that number is prime. So its factorization, the log is just the whole thing. It's definitely more than half of it. A smooth factorization would look like this. We have a polynomial of degree 3. So its log is 3. And then we factor into 3 linear factors. So, you know, the log of, there's a log of 3 factored into something with log 1. All right, this is terrible. Sorry. Let me write it as 3 equals 1 plus 1 plus 1. And each piece has a log that's definitely not as big as half of the original thing. So this is like a pretty good factorization. We factored into pretty small pieces. That's smooth. Here's for permutations, how does this look? Okay, so this one we did before, we broke 5 into 3 plus 2. So here I am, Alex, it's funny, you said I was in this movie like talking about partitions, and like here I am doing it again, becoming very typecast. Okay. So this is not smooth, right? Because 3 is more than half of 5. In fact, if I were to write down a permutation and a smooth factorization, it would have to have at least 3 parts, maybe 2, 2, and 1. So let's do one. So I could switch A and D. So there's a part of size 2, and then maybe I switch B and C, and then let's let E be a fixed point. And then I would have 2, 2, and 1. The AD cycle, the BC cycle, and then E is by itself. So this would be smooth. And this would not. So here's a question. If I look at, I just admitted somebody from the waiting room. Somebody came very late. They're just going to come for the grand finale. So let's say I look at all the permutations. Let's fix some number of letters, n. Then how many permutations are there? There are n factorial. It's a pretty big number. By the way, I learned while researching the book that so I was writing a whole section about card shuffling. My old undergraduate advisor, Percy Diaconis, is the master of this study. And of course, then you really need to know how many shuffles are there, how many ways are there to arrange the 52 cards in a deck, 52 factorial. I learned that actually there was a time when people wanted to call that number 52 admiration. They still use the exclamation point, but they were so impressed by the huge size of these numbers that they thought admiration would be a better name than factorial for it. That didn't catch on, we call it factorial, but in any event, it's very big. With 5, there's actually only, there's 120 ways to permute these 5 things. Even for 10, it's much bigger, it's like about 3.6 million. So there's a lot of these different permutations. And now here's a question, how many of them are smooth? Now, that would probably take you a long time to count, right? So maybe instead of saying literally how many, say what percentage of them are smooth. And here's an amazing fact that I think I don't really know like why you would have the intuition that this would be true until you start to study these things, that no matter how big N is, the proportion of how many of those permutations are smooth doesn't change very much. It's always about the same. And it's always just a little more than 30%. Now, if you think that's crazy, let me show you this other facts in the next slide, which are the following. I could do a similar thing and say, look at all the numbers. Okay, not all the numbers, because that's infinitely many, but just pick some large threshold, look at all the numbers up to a million, and see how many of them have a smooth factorization. That's also a little more than 30%. What if I take a random polynomial, mod 5, or mod 7, or mod 3, doesn't matter, of of degree up to 100 or something and say, how many of them have smooth factorizations? 30.7% again. So this, here's the thing, this notion of smoothness makes sense in any context in which you have a factorization. Okay, I don't think it makes sense for pants, to be fair. Any of these kind of arithmetic style things in which you have a factorization. And yet these problems are totally different, right? Numbers are one kind of thing. Polynomials with coefficients mod 5 are another kind of thing. And permutations are a third kind of thing. And yet, this these structural questions about what proportion of the things are smooth is exactly the same in all three cases. Okay, that is certainly not a coincidence. And we could just like start right here and give like a whole hour talk about why these three things are related under the skin. Well, we don't have time to do that, and I haven't prepared slides for it, but I don't have to because this gives me an opportunity. I know we pitched my book a little bit tonight. Let me pitch somebody else's book because my colleague and Alex's, Andrew Granville, a great analytic number theorist in Montreal, actually has written a book exactly about this. Not only has he written a book about this, he did something kind of crazy. He wrote a graphic novel about it. I'll show you the cover. And actually, on my slide, I cut off the bottom of the cover that has Andrew's name on it, so I wrote it here, Andrew Granville. But I misspelled it. Way to go, me. Andrew Granville with two L's. Okay, there we go. Prime suspect. You see that it's about integers and permutations, but it's about polynomials too. So he somehow had the crazy idea, but kind of brilliant too, of transforming, of telling this kind of mathematical story in the context of like a sort of graphic novel murder mystery, which I can highly recommend to you. And if you want sort of part two of this talk, maybe that's where you will find it. So with that, thank you for indulging me as we went a little bit over time. I really enjoyed hearing from all you guys. That's what I have to say. So I'm happy to hang out and talk about any of this stuff or really anything else or whatever. Thank you guys so much for coming.